our lungs have this neat little trick. It's called hypoxic vasoconstriction, but it's basically a way of describing how the lungs behave to maximize their function. I've drawn you this little diagram here to show you how the blood vessel system interacts with the air spaces in the lungs. And this little phenomenon actually has to do with how they interact as well. So the hypoxic part is referring to the fact that it's low in O2. So the lungs' job is to carry O2 or oxygen to our bodies, right? So when it's low in oxygen, it's hypoxic. And vasoconstriction is basically a stricture. So if you have your vessel going like this, vasoconstriction is when they get restricted and the diameter actually decreases. So on this diagram, the green thing is a terminal unit in the lung. This is an alveolus. Air comes in here. This is where gas exchange happens. So the air in here is higher in oxygen content. So the oxygen goes from here into the blood. And at the same time, the carbon dioxide, which is the waste that the blood is carrying, to the heart and lungs, it gets into our lungs, then gets breathed out. So the hypoxic part is really referring to what happens in this green airspace. So for some reason, that has to do with the lungs, we're low in oxygen there. And then the vasoconstriction has to do with the blood vessel system. Do you see how it kind of flows around the lung tissue? So like I said before, it's a cause and effect relationship. Because of hypoxia, something happens to our blood vessel. So first, let's look at how this usually works. If this is a very healthy lung, healthy blood vessel, all the airways are open, we're filled with air in both these sacs. So we'd have deoxygenated blood flowing in here. This is my blue stream. It's going to be the deoxygenated blood full of carbon dioxide. It flows both ways through the fork. It's going to come in down here. And this is going to be a gradient, but I'm going to have to draw it kind of abruptly because I don't know how to draw a gradient. So now the gas exchange is happening between this air sac and the blood vessel. And as the blood flows through, it eventually becomes red, full of oxygen. And at this point, it's going to be going back into the heart to be pumped to the body. So this is how the normal relationship works. I'm going to erase everything I just drew. Let's look at what happens if one of these air sacs is out of commission. So I'm going to block off this side. So now as the blood is coming in here, the lungs realize that if you go this side, there's not going to be much gas exchange. It realizes that there's hypoxia within this little pocket. And the body literally comes in here at this point and restricts this path leading to the hypoxic area of the lung. This changes the diameter of the lumen this side to be much smaller, and blood is directed or redirected, I should say, more of it over to this side. So it's now going to be mostly on this side. And here, assuming this airway is still nice and open, we still get the same thing. Blood picks up oxygen, becomes red, and it flows out. On this side, of course, some blood still gets through. It's not going to be closed off completely. But the blood coming this way is going to be significantly less because there's higher pressure. And blood, remember, wants to go the path of lowest resistance. So it goes like that. And we see that this actually maximizes the amount of oxygen we can still deliver because we've shunted more of the blood over to the side that works better. So this here, the color might be a little purplish because we have some mixing with the blue blood, but it's still mostly red. And the restriction here allows us to stay red like this by giving most of the blood over to the side that works. So I've drawn this on a very zoomed in scale, showing you how this happens in one alveolus versus another. But this can be more global. Just draw a pair of lungs really quick. We have the trachea leading to the main stem bronchi. The lungs arise like that. We have our left and right sides. Yep. And remember that the blood supply follows the path of the airway. So just like the airway branches, the blood supply does too. It goes into millions of different branches, same on both sides. And like we said before, because the blood supply is distributed according to how well that area is receiving oxygen, we might see a lot of unevenness on a global scale. So let's say down here there's good air, All these branches get a lot of blood. Fill that in. Looks like chicken feet. But for some reason, on the side of the lung, up here we're not getting a lot of air. So the blood supply will be thinner here. There's restriction of the vessels. So with this side, it might be completely different. So where the hypoxia is depends on what's causing it. So maybe down here, there's not as much good blood, so it's thinner. Now, this whole mechanism was intended to be an emergency way of dealing with sudden hypoxia, or at least it's a temporary measure. And it also assumes that only some areas of the lungs are affected. But what happens if you have a condition that affects all the areas of the lungs? Then if there's global, chronic hypoxic vasoconstriction, think about it, then a lot of the vessels will be affected and it will be constricted day after day, month after month. Over time, this will give us a new condition. You might have guessed this is where we're going. We're gonna get pulmonary hypertension because the blood pressure in these vessels are so elevated all the time that it becomes a condition on its own. Remember that this tends to happen when it becomes a chronic problem, and also when the restriction and the hypoxia we're talking about tends to be global, meaning not just in one alveolus, but in larger sections of the lungs. Because if there's not good air anywhere, then everywhere we're gonna have vasoconstriction, and that in itself directly leads to hypertension. And when it's so chronic and the tension doesn't come back down, then we have a pulmonary hypertension chronic problem on our hands. So what can lead to low oxygen hypoxia everywhere? So again, we come to some of the usual pulmonary problems. So emphysema, as an example, or chronic bronchitis. A lot of the diseases that can result from smoking or chronic exposure to irritants. The lungs become less effective in moving air, we're hypoxic everywhere. Another one might be long exposure to high altitudes. So when the altitude is high, the air is thinner, and we literally have less oxygen in the air. So hypoxia is gonna be there all the time. And thinking of other long chronic diseases, we have asthma. A lot of people who have asthma eventually develop pulmonary hypertension. And these are just some examples to show you that hypoxic vasoconstriction is basically a pathophysiology or a story of how lung problems that had nothing to do with the blood vessels in the first place can eventually cause a blood vessel problem in the lungs. It will lead to a whole host of other problems that we call pulmonary hypertension.